morning. Great to see you here this morning. And I mean, I know I say it practically every time I'm here, but this is one of my favorite views of this worship center here because of what this signifies. Something special happens here today. Now, I don't say that in the sense then to imply that any other time that we gather is not special. Because when we come together in the presence of the Lord, I mean, we need to have that sense that it is truly special. However, when we gather, like we gather today, and I get to look at you from here, that means that we've come to remember, to celebrate, to make a commitment to this God who loves us as we, as a family, recognize and celebrate with this family, the Moon family, today as Lauren and Landon show the world what's already happened in their hearts and lives. And that's what baptism is all about. Baptism doesn't wash your sins away. Baptism is not the saving act. You are not saved until you're baptized. That's not what it's about. In Scripture, we're told, Jesus says, he was baptized. He wants us to be baptized as an act of obedience to him. And so ones who have given their hearts and lives to Jesus, then they come to these waters, and it could be waters really anywhere. I've baptized in the lake, in the river, at a swimming pool, in a bathtub. But they come to the water to symbolize what's already happened. That Lauren, that Landon, that didn't know Jesus is gone. Scripture tells us that what Christ offers is new life. And so the waters of the baptistry symbolize a death and a burial and a resurrection to new life. And Landon and Lauren, they come today to show the world what has already happened in their hearts and lives and to be obedient to this one that they say is in charge of their lives. And we as a church family have a responsibility. Number one, to worship with them. And then number two, to serve alongside, to grow alongside, for us then to truly be that family as we serve Christ together here. We are carrying out the Great Commission. Christ, after he was crucified, Mary came to the tomb and encountered him there, and he said, go back and tell them to meet me where I told them I would be. And in Matthew 28, the disciples go and they meet Jesus. It said, you know, many of them worshiped, but some doubted. They still weren't quite sure. And then he gives them their marching orders, tells them, tells us today, what we are to be about as followers of Jesus Christ. He says, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given unto me. And as a result, he says, I'm giving you authority as you go, while you're going. He says, you know, go out into the world. Make disciples. Baptizing in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost, teaching them to obey everything that I've commanded you. We're carrying out that part of baptism. And then we will grow together as we learn and teach and serve and share together. And his promise is, in that passage and for us today, is that he will be with us always. Always. To the very end of the age. He's with us today. Continue to be with us in the days that he allows us to continue to live and to love and to serve him here or wherever we may be. And so I hope that you as family, you as brothers and sisters in Christ here in this church family, that today as we observe baptism, I hope that you will think of your own. Remember that time that you showed the world that Christ was the one who was in charge. If you haven't, if you've given your heart and life to Him and you haven't been baptized, we got plenty of water, we got plenty of towels. Come on. I'm not kidding, okay? I say that somewhat flippantly, but I'm serious. Today can be the day. Don't put it off. If you haven't given your heart and life to Jesus Christ, I pray that today would be the day. From this testimony that you see and that we share together. This is Lauren Moon. Now, Lauren gave her heart and life to Christ in our Awana program a few years back. And she wanted to think and have a time there. And over the course of this spring, she said, yes, now's the time. I want the world to know what's happened. She has been open in her and living for Christ. And she wanted to follow through in baptism. And Lauren, is Jesus in charge of your life? When you come today to follow Him in obedience in baptism, well, Lauren, because of your public profession of faith in Christ and your desire to follow Him in obedience in baptism, I baptize you, my Christian sister, Lauren Moon, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Buried with Christ in baptism and raised to walk in newness of life. Bible school. And again, in the spring, in this time there, he says, I want to do what I know I need to do. I want to be baptized. He too has been bold in living his faith, but comes today to show the world what has happened. Landon, is Jesus in charge of your life?
Yes.
And you come today to follow Him in obedience in baptism.
Yes.
Then Landon, on your public profession of faith in Christ and your desire to follow Him in obedience in baptism, I baptize you, my Christian brother, Landon Moon, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Buried with Christ in baptism and raised to walk in newness of life. Let's pray together and let's sing with this glorious God. Father, we do. We thank you for the privilege you give us to join you in what you're already at work in doing here in this church, in this community, in our state, throughout our nation, around the world. Father, I thank you for faithful brothers and sisters that taught Bible school, that shared in Awana, impacted these lives. I thank you for a mom and dad, for grandparents, for brothers, Father, for others that you also used to share your love and life, your message of salvation and hope to Landon and Lauren. Father, and we thank you. Decisions that they made years ago that they've lived out from that day. And then today, it's beautiful, beautiful testimony to what's already happened in their lives. And now to show the world that you're the one who's in charge. Father, thank you for those that have come, family members and others, for this time, and then for our time of worship, celebration, praise today. We give you honor. We don't pretend to understand the circumstances we find ourselves in. We know families that have lost loved ones this week. We know those that are at risk on the front lines every day. Father, we thank you that you're right there with them. Father, I thank you that you're right here today. Holy Spirit, continue to lead us and guide us as we continue to worship. And you are the one that leads us to worship in spirit and in truth. We want God alone honored today. Thank you for loving us through Jesus, giving us a reason to sing and to share. Let us do that now to your praise and glory. In Jesus' name.
Amen. All right. Our first song this morning is Are You Washed in the Blood? And Chris reminded me that there may be some people here who aren't really familiar with where this song comes from. if you're one of our young people, you're probably just taught in school that, well, you just really need to be grossed out by blood-borne pathogens. Blood is one of the best ways to catch a disease from someone. And that is not the context in which this song was written. It's more, obviously, it goes back to the plan of salvation, that Jesus would shed his blood on the cross and give his life to in basically a war against the powers of darkness and the power of Satan in people's lives, that they might be set free from sin and be able to live a life that honors and glorifies God. Revolutionary War was a really prime example of why this song would be relevant. As you saw thousands of people shedding their blood and giving their lives. Any veteran knows that you don't win a war without shedding blood and losing lives. And the same thing happened in the Civil War about the time this song was written, that the people were giving all they could give in order to see right be victorious. And so if you're washed in the blood, then it's something to celebrate. It means that you have accepted the gift that Jesus Christ bought for you on the cross of Calvary. Let's stand together and worship. Have you been to Jesus for the cleansing power? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you fully trusting in His grace this hour? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed in the blood, in the soul-cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you walking daily by the Savior's side? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Do you rest each moment in the crucified? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed in the blood, in the soul-cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Lay aside the garments that are stained with sin and be washed in the blood of the Lamb. There's a fountain flowing for the soul unclean. Oh, be washed in the blood of the Lamb. Are you washed in the blood, in the soul-cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Oh, how He loves you and me. Oh, how He loves you and me. He gave His life. What more could He give? Oh, how He loves you. Oh, how He loves me. Oh, how He loves you and me. Jesus to Calvary did go. From despair,
Glad to see you here. Glad everybody turned out to celebrate this baptism this morning. I like seeing the pews full again. It feels a little bit more like normal. I wanted to just give a few quick updates on things and then just share a little bit and pray. There really aren't announcements other than continue to pray for our teachers and students as we get ready to go back to school. And if you would, please pray for my dad. His vision's getting really bad, and so we're going to go get that checked out, and hopefully it'll turn out well. He couldn't read very good in the first place, though. But I did want to share a little bit about Paraperu. It's a ministry organization that we're closely affiliated with, and throughout the pandemic, they've had kind of a new ministry because they haven't been able to do their weekly Bible studies. And so what they're doing right now is a food ministry and just sharing off of their Facebook page. Lauren, the person in charge, she said that on March 16th, the Peruvian president declared a strict quarantine, and that quarantine lasted 107 days. It ended on June 30th. They're still in a state of emergency through the end of July, is what they said, and I think they're still kind of are. A lot of people having trouble getting jobs and things like that, from what I hear. Here are just some statistics. 14,500 people texted or sent messages to asking for help to receive services. 13,000 people they were actually able to reach and set up an appointment. 9,293 Venezuelan refugees and Peruvian families received bags of food. And each one of them got the chance to hear the gospel before they received their food and any family members that came with them. 800 times the gospel was shared. 10 sessions a day with 12 people in each session for 97 days of giving out food. That's 120 people a day. Not to mention the people who she told me about would come and beat on their door begging, saying, hey, we're about to starve to death. 500 repeated bags for their church members, volunteers, neighbors, and police officers. There's still about 1,500 people waiting to be contacted to receive help. And in total, 9,973 food bags were handed out. There are tons of donors from the United States who have helped make that possible. I think she told me something like every time they would buy food for about 2 weeks, it was about $15,000 worth of American money. And our currency is about three times more than Peruvian money. And so an incredible ministry they've been doing, and anyone who's been praying for them, anyone who's supported financially, your money's not being wasted. They are working 14, 16-hour days, and this is probably anywhere from about three to six people doing this. This is not some organization. This is just a few folks who want to do good. They recently had to shut down to just quarantine. They were just worried about their health, and they've been cleared. And as of Friday, I believe, they've gone back to it. And so they're going to keep doing this for the foreseeable future till they can get back to doing their normal ministry stuff. So continue to pray for them. Continue to pray for the people of Peru, the Venezuelan refugees, everyone who's kind of in that tough situation. We think it's bad here. It's bad all the way around. But I did want to share a quick word out of Joshua 24:15. It says, but if serving the Lord seems undesirable to you, then choose for yourself this day whom you will serve, whether the gods of your ancestors served beyond the Euphrates or the gods of the Amorites in whose land you were living. But as for me and my household, we will serve the Lord. I don't know if you guys know this about me. I work with teenagers. I've mentioned that once or twice. It is a defining character trait of me. And I've learned one thing about teenagers. They are hardwired to take wise counsel and ignore it completely. And so as I continue to work with the beautiful youth of Valley View, I have to remember that their ability to do things in this world, to go places, to make the right decisions, is not based on me And I have to remind myself of that continually. But what is based on me is how I love them and how I respond to them. And the only way that I can love them and respond to them is if I know Jesus, who loved across the board. He loved all people. He loved them despite their race, their religion, their practices, their lifestyle choices. And so I have to continually remind myself of that every day. And I think we do too, as we try our hardest to display grace to each other. We can't love each other unless we love like Jesus. And so with that, please join me as we pray. Father, thank you for this church family. Thank you for the celebration of baptism, Lord. As Glenn talked about, it is nothing special. It's just water, but it is the symbolism. It is the obedience and following just like you did, Christ, Lord. And we're so thankful for Landon and Lauren finally being able to do this, and it's a special day for people to remember them. And Lord, we just pray as we continue forward in times of uncertainty, as we continue to step back into school, as we get ready for the election, all these scary things that have tons of reasons to divide us, Lord, we pray that we as a church, as a body, that we won't let it. Lord, we hold the power, not the darkness in this world. And let us remember that. Let us be people who follow you unashamedly and people who follow you despite how bad it might make us look or how tough it makes our lives, Lord. Because we want to be sold out for you, Lord, because you loved us so much even to the point of death. And so as we reflect on the things that you've done, as Glenn brings this message, Lord, we continue to pray for just the things going on in this world that we continue to hear about, Lord, the darkness that comes from the exploitation of women and children, and we pray about the people suffering, the refugees, and we pray for the people of Lebanon, Lord, as this crisis that we've seen. Lord, we know that even in the darkest times, even when it feels like you're being silent, Lord, you're knitting together a plan, and that's hard. That's a hard reality to know that you're good in spite of all of this, but we know that you are. We love you and we praise you. In Christ's name we pray, amen.
Amen.
I'm telling you guys, it is so good to see all your faces and to see your smiles and just to be with people. This has been driving me crazy. And I've always been the kind of person who has said, I could be a hermit, but I have learned that I could not be a hermit. Even I need to people. And I need this weekly gathering. I really do, and I think all of you do too. And you also probably know, if you know me at all, you know that I love to sing a new song. And I'm going to teach you a new one today. The song that we're going to learn that's going to be the piped in music, actually it just starts with him singing. So there's no introduction where you can kind of get ready. It just starts. But the really neat thing about this is that there are really only about three notes that you need to sing. You don't have to go up higher or down. It's three notes. Those are just the three notes you gotta sing. And it starts out, it goes, through every battle, through every heartbreak, through every circumstance, I believe that you are my fortress, you are my portion, you are my hiding place. I believe you are the way, the truth, the life. I believe you are. Do the same thing. Straight on scripture. What a great song that we could be singing this morning. So Isaac, you'll give it, you'll start it. We'll start along with it.
Through every battle,
with words, please.
Through every heartbreak, through every circumstance, I believe that you are my fortress. You are my portion. You are my hiding place.
Thank you, Chris, for leading Rick. Thank you, Isaac, always, so much help there. And it is, I had not heard. Chris posted this song a couple of weeks ago. I had never heard it. And so I listened. And I loved. And so I emailed this week and asked her to teach this to us today, and we will sing it again, needless to say. But it is. Just like one that we had sung a few weeks back, about a month back. This song, absolutely grounded in Scripture. And so, Isaac, if you would, this is something we hadn't talked about. If you put the words back up and just kind of follow me through with that song, if you would, please. But I thought about it in terms of baptism today. And Lauren and Landon, but then just thinking about baptism, thinking about evangelism, thinking about just the message of life and hope, salvation through Jesus Christ. And the words of this song, of course, it talks about, these are really proclamation statements of testimony, truth. But I was thinking about this song in terms of truly an overall question. Do you know the one? Can you say that you know that you have one that is with you through every battle? every heartbreak, every circumstance? Do you truly believe that Jesus is your fortress? That he is your portion, the one who keeps you going, the one who gives you strength and hope? Is he your hiding place, the one that you know that you can go to at any time, again, no matter what the battle, no matter what the heartbreak, no matter what the circumstance, and you know that you are safe with him? Do you know him as the way, the truth, the life? Do you know him as the one that blesses always, as the one that you can count on his every promise? Are you the one who can say that through every breath you take, that you believe that he is your provider, your protector? Is he the one that you truly love with all of your heart, soul, mind, and strength? Is he the one that truly is your new horizon? I loved that phrase. It's a new horizon. It's a new morning, a new day, a new start. It says, and I'm set on you. Are you the one that's set on Jesus Christ? Your heart is set on him because of his passionate love for you. He meets us here today with mercies that are new. I pray that all your fears and doubts can come to you. Cast them on him because he cares for you. They can't stay long. I hope that you know this one today, Jesus Christ. And the scripture in all of this, but it there in John chapter 14, Jesus is preparing his disciples for his crucifixion and his ascension, leaving them physically. And here in chapter 14, it says Jesus comforts his disciples, and he begins, but he says, "Don't let your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. My Father's house has many rooms. If that were not so, would I have told you that I'm going there to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I'll come back and take you to be with me, that you also may be where I am. You know the way to the place I'm going." It's like, so that's that phrase there. Every battle, every heartbreak, every circumstance, he says, he's your fortress, your portion, your hiding place. He continues in chapter 14, verse 5. He says, up there in verse 4, "You know the way to the place where I'm going." Thomas said to him, "Lord, we don't know where you're going, so how can we know the way?" Thomas, I think that he's been mischaracterized in Scripture. We refer to him as doubting Thomas, this question, and then another time where he says, I got to see the nails in his hands. I've got to see where the spear, I've got to put my hand where the spear went into his side. I'm not going to believe until that. Doubting Thomas. But it's interesting to me. The guys, they were gathered there in that upper room, fearful of what the Roman soldiers might do to them, what the Roman government might do to them there in Jerusalem. And yet, who wasn't in that room? Thomas. Thomas was somewhere else. Thomas had left. Thomas had risked kind of going out on his own. I don't think of Thomas as the doubter, as some timid soul. When Jesus had basically been kicked out of a town, and they threatened him, he left, and he was performing miracles, and he got news that his friend Lazarus was sick, and he didn't go back for 4 days, and then he was going back, and Thomas and them, they were all with him. There was a time when he was headed up to Jerusalem, and they knew, his disciples knew that he was going to be, there had been threats against his life. And they basically said, we don't want to go. And Thomas said, basically, Jesus, if you go, I'll go with you. Thomas, okay, that's just a little aside there. But Thomas just said what the other guys were thinking. Lord, we don't know where you're going. How can we know the way? And so Jesus answers, I am the way, the truth, the life. It says, if no one can come to the Father but through me, if you really know me, you will know my Father as well. From now on, you do know him and you have seen him. If you have given your heart and life to Jesus Christ, you know God the Father, and you've seen him. And that's what we've been talking about over the last couple of weeks, about seeing Jesus. Seeing Jesus instead of the delusions of this world, the lies that we find around us all the time. We talk about seeing Jesus rather than the divisions that separate us on so many different levels. We talked about seeing Jesus rather than the disappointments of the people around us. And the reality is, I mean, that is the world in which we live. A world of delusions, a world of divisions, a world of disappointments. And we as followers of Jesus Christ, we are called to focus on none of that. We are called to focus on him, this one who is the way, the truth, the life, the one that we can believe through every blessing, every promise, every breath we take, that he is provider, protector, and that we must love him. And that new horizon where we can be set on him, you meet us here today with mercies that are new, that's a verse out of the most kind of unlikely of places, in my opinion. But there's a book in the Old Testament that is basically called Despair. It's the book of Lamentations. And this verse, this phrase here in this song is taken directly from the book of Lamentations. Lamenting so many things, but in Lamentations chapter 3, beginning with verse 19, we find these words. The writer here of Lamentations says, I remember my affliction and my wandering, the bitterness and the gall. Life has been hard, difficult. It stinks. The bitterness and the gall, I remember. I well remember them, and my soul is downcast within me. I'm wallowing in my own guilt and regret and circumstances of my life. My every battle, every heartache, every circumstance. I well remember, and my soul is downcast within me. And then that beautiful word, yet. But that's not the whole story. Yet this I call to mind, and therefore I have hope. He doesn't call to mind. Yes, he says, I remember the affliction and wandering, bitterness and gall. My soul is downcast within me. I remember that. And then he says, but this I recall. I am intentional in calling this to mind. And what does he call to mind? Because of the Lord's great love, I may have trouble, but I'm not consumed. I'm still here. And what does he say? Because of the Lord's great love, I'm not consumed. Why? For his compassions never fail. He knows right where you are. He knows the circumstances that you're involved in. He knows the ones that are on your horizon. He knows what's to come. He knows where you are, and yet his compassion, he loves you. He feels for you. God is not this intricate machine in the sky that has no feelings. He is the God who loves you. He's the God who sent his son to die for you. His compassions are sometimes there. That's not what he says. Your compassions never fail. They, his compassions, the steadfast love of the Lord, new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. Now, the writer here didn't have the phrases, but we do. And so, great is your faithfulness. You are the way. You are the truth. You are the life. God. Verse 24, Lamentations 3:24. I say to myself, again, an intentional act. I say to myself, the Lord is my portion. We just sang that. The Lord is my portion, therefore I'll wait on him. I'll trust him. I will know that he is my hiding place, that he is my provider, my protector. The Lord, verse 25, is good to those whose hope is in him, to the one who seeks him. It's good to wait quietly for the salvation of the Lord. That phrase up there, the three things that I want us to look at, and we'll be done this morning, but here, I want us to think about what happens to us as we're caught up in circumstances and situations that we don't know, that we don't understand. And what happens is our mind then often goes to worst case scenarios or remembers the worst things that have happened to us or things that God has allowed us to hurt through, endure. And that's where this starts here in Lamentations 3. I remember my affliction. It comes into my head almost without my desiring it to. My wandering, the bitterness, the gall. That can happen to us. What it takes for us to get rid of that, to move beyond that, is not to turn on more news, not to flip through Facebook anymore, not to get on Instagram, not to get on whatever your news feed is, but to be intentional down in verse 21, and to call to mind those things that God has blessed you with. We sang Count Your Many Blessings last Sunday. We had a couple three share blessings during this time of pandemic and during this time of uncertainty. I hope that you, each one of you, will. I hope that you went home last week and did some of that this week. But that you will intentionally call to mind. You'll intentionally remember. You will be diligent about saying, here is where God showed himself to me in the past. Here is where I am blessed today. Here is where he is at work in me, around me. And the people that I love, I can see him here. Because friends, we've talked about this so many times on so many different levels here. But when you will find what you look for. And if what you are anticipating seeing in the midst of circumstances today is confusion, is deceit, you'll find it. You'll find it. If what you're committed to and what you are seeking is this one who is your blessing, your promise, who's with you every breath you take, your provider, your protector, if you look for him, guess what? You'll find him too. But you've got to do it on purpose. You got to look for Jesus. You got to look for where the Holy Spirit is at work. You got to look. This I call to mind, And what happens is he brings hope. Hope. Hope, not wishful thinking. We've talked about this over the years as well. Hope is that confident assurance that God is going to do what he says that he's going to do. That is our hope. A confident assurance in this God. And our hope comes when we call to mind his great love there in verse 22. And the fact that, as we talked about, kind of as this all began, I looked back over some of my messages at the beginning of this, but talked about the fact that if you're sitting here today, God has a 100% track record of bringing you through whatever the circumstances have been in your life. Okay? He can be trusted. Because of the Lord's great love, we are not consumed. You're still here. He's got a plan and a purpose for you. His compassions, his passionate, personal love for you that is made clear, evident to us through his Son, Jesus Christ, his compassions new every morning. They never fail. You can count on him. Trust him. Your compassions never fail. They are new every morning. I've heard people talk about the Christian life as one where God wipes your slate clean every morning, every day. That's not my theology. My theology, in terms of he doesn't re-forgive your sins. He doesn't, you know, kind of re-save you every day. And I've heard people kind of talk about that. That's not it. The compassions that are new every morning is that this day is a fresh day in your relationship with him. And he wants to lead and guide you in the best way forward with him. His compassions are new every morning. What do we talk about? Grace. We talk about his love. God doesn't give you enough love to make it through the next month. He gives you enough love. He gives you enough grace. He gives you enough power to make it through today. Today. And you know what he does tomorrow? If he gives us that day tomorrow, he gives us enough grace, enough love, enough power to make it through tomorrow as well. His compassions never fail. His love for us is shown through Jesus Christ. And Jesus Christ, as we've talked about, he's the same yesterday, today, and forever. He's the one absolutely that we can count on. That's that new horizon. And we can be set on him, and he will meet us here today with new mercies, new compassions. For us, his love and his faithfulness. He is the one that you and I can and must trust. Even when I come to those times where I get in God's face and say, God, this makes absolutely no sense to me, there are times when I imagine God's response to that is saying, and? he says, I don't promise you that you're going to understand everything. I don't promise you that you're going to know everything that I'm doing. In fact, what I've told you is that my ways are not your ways. My ways are beyond your ways. You see through a mirror dimly. But you can trust me. I have the big picture. And I'll guide you every step of the way. His faithfulness is great. I hope that that is your testimony, that you know that his faithfulness to you. And so the writer is, what do you, I say to myself. And I hope then this is what we can, again, it's another intentional act. Something that you have to make yourself. You have to say, this is what I'm going to do. I say to myself, the Lord is my portion. That doesn't mean I get a little piece of the Lord. I get this little portion. No. That word portion there, the Lord is what fills me. The Lord is my portion. The Lord is the one who takes care of me. He is the one who guides and protects. The Lord is my portion. Therefore, I say this to myself. Not saying it to anybody else. I'm saying this to me. He says, the Lord is my portion. What will I do? Therefore, I will wait on him. Wait. Trust. Remain. Stay. Stand. I'll wait for him. Now, waiting in Scripture is never sit back and twiddle your thumbs. Never. Waiting in Scripture is us, as we've talked about before again, doing the next right thing. Doing what we know that we are called to do and waiting for the Lord to continue to lead wherever that may be. I'll wait on him. I'll continue what I'm doing and I'll trust him to come, to guide, to show, to share. I say to myself, the Lord is the one who fills me. The Lord is the one who empowers me, and I am going to trust him as I continue to live for him. The Lord is good to those whose hope is in him. To the one who seeks him. There it is again, that intentional act. You remember, you intentionally remember, you say to yourself, and you wait. And you seek. You seek him. It's good to wait quietly for the salvation of the Lord. That is what he calls us to do. That is what we sang. And Isaac, if we could, I want us to sing this again as we prepare to go today. I want this to be our testimony today. The way, new horizons. And so, even as you started, we'll kind of join as the words come. But I hope that this is your testimony today. Let's sing. Battle. Through every heartbreak, through every circumstance, I believe that you are my fortress, you are my portion, you are my hiding place. I believe you are the way, the truth, the life. I believe you are the way, the truth, the life. I believe you are. Through every promise, through every breath I take, I believe that you are provider, you are protector, you are the one I love. I believe you are the way, the truth, the life. I believe you are the way, the truth, the life. I believe you are.
Oh, you are. Oh, you are. It's a new horizon, and I'm set on you. And you meet me here today with mercies that are new. All my fears and doubts, they can all come too, because they can't stay long when I am here with you. It's a new horizon, and I'm set on you. And you meet me here today with mercies that are new. All my fears and doubts, they can all come too, because they can't stay long when I believe you are the way, the truth, the life. I believe you are the way, the truth, the life. I believe you are the new horizon, and I'm set on you. And you meet me here today with mercies that are new. All my fears and doubts, they can all come true, because they can't stay long when I believe you are the way, the truth, the life. I believe you are the way, the truth, the life. I believe you are.
I hope, I mean, as you say, I believe you are. I hope that truly is what you believe. As we prepare to go today, I ask you to remember Melanie Brown's mother. She's been sick for about 3 weeks. Passed out last night, was taken by ambulance to the hospital. She's at Denton Presbyterian. And so if you remember Melanie, her dad, her mom. If you'd also remember the family of Otis Barthold, he passed away yesterday. And so if you'd remember that family, needless to say, longtime Valley View family, and worked at NCTC for years. And then where I saw him most in the last few years was sitting out front at Walmart, and I talked to him there. But if you'd remember Otis's family, continue to remember Risa, continue to remember Vicki McKnight, been diagnosed with non-Hodgkin's lymphoma and starting treatment there. And so if you'd remember them, others that we need to be aware of as we pray. Thank you, Glenn. Bill Dering has a massive infection around his eye and was on drip antibiotics. He actually went to the hospital as well, and so please continue to remember Bill and Patty, his daughter here in town. She helps him. Others? All right. If you'll remain seated, we will pray and then we will go. Rick, would you lead us as we pray this morning, please?
Father, we're so very grateful for all of your blessings, those that have been encouraged by the truths of your word, and those that are encouraged by